Hello, my name is Brad Goodfellow. I work at SGU and I'll be presenting in this vignette the methods that we've been using to assess coastal erosion in southern Sweden. There is a total of 9 slides and this vignette lasts for about 8 minutes. Inspired by 3 SGU reports, I will start by briefly answering 2 questions. Is erosion a problem? And why measure coastal erosion? I will then introduce the methodology that SGU has used to assess coastal erosion from aerial photography and present its advantages and disadvantages. Examples of long-term erosion in Skåne will be highlighted, and we will conclude with a summary of planned future studies. So, is erosion a problem? Well, that depends. Erosion is a natural coastal process. It can become a problem, firstly, if it persists over many years rather than occurring in a cycle that includes accumulation of sediment that naturally repairs eroded coasts. Secondly, if the drivers of erosion are man-made, for example, by interfering with natural sediment dynamics through coastal development or by increasing sea level by warming the planet. In the example shown here, the construction of urban infrastructure and groynes perpendicular to the coast have blocked the north-south longshore sediment transport system, resulting in erosion and landwards migration of a barrier island to the south. Thirdly, erosion also becomes a problem if it threatens buildings, infrastructure, or recreational resources. The example shows recent erosion along Lake Michigan, which forms a good analog for the Baltic Sea. At SGU, assessing erosion has been a part of a general assessment of coastal change over time, which also includes accumulation. Accumulation can also be a problem, for example, by infilling of river mouths, which can restrict or pose a hazard to boating. A great example of this is the Tweed River in eastern Australia. The river mouth was regularly infilled by sand, which posed a major boating hazard. To mitigate that problem, seawalls were built at the river mouth, but these blocked the northwards transport of sand, which led to accumulation in the river mouth and to its south, and erosion of the beaches to the north. This problem has now been solved by the installation of a sand pump, which transports sand from the south through pipes under the river and deposits it on beaches to the north. Why measure coastal erosion? We measure coastal erosion because it is an essential part of coastal risk assessment for society. By knowing how much erosion is occurring, where it is occurring, and why it is occurring, we can develop appropriate mitigation measures. Note, however, that the interpretation of appropriate has changed over time. From building hard structures, such as vertical concrete walls, to wherever possible, implementing softer engineering solutions and nature-based solutions, such as beach nourishment at Istad. The interpretation of appropriate also depends on local factors. For example, a hard defence might still be unavoidable where buildings and critical infrastructure are located at an eroding coastline. Measuring coastal erosion also provides important background information to help us understand how the coast might respond to future sea level rise, together with many additional types of information and analyses. There are different methods to assess coastal erosion. SGU has done this from aerial photography. We do this by viewing ortho-rectified aerial photographs from different years. The earlier of the 2 years is the reference year, whereas the latter of the 2 years is the comparison year. In the example shown here, 2007 is the reference year and 2018 will be the comparison year. We then choose a line to map in a geographic information system. This may, for example, be the waterline or the line marking the base of the sand dune behind the beach. In this example, we have chosen the dune foot. We then map this line for both the reference year and the comparison year. Then we use tools in the GIS to divide each line into equal segments and then calculate the distances between these line segments. Finally, we assign the distances between the lines as either accumulation or erosion. We then report the numbers and show the lines on maps. There are a number of advantages of assessing coastal erosion from aerial photographs. It's cheap because it is done from existing publicly available imagery and uses ArcGIS, which we already use widely and therefore have a license for. It is quick and easy compared with, for example, detailed field surveys. Most importantly, though, it's effective because long sections of coast can be assessed. For example, we have done all of Skåne and Halland. It gives a record of change over years to decades, thereby allowing assessment of both short-term trends and the more important long-term trends. With high-resolution colour imagery, measurements can be done with high precision and accuracy. There are also a number of disadvantages of assessing coastal erosion from aerial photographs. In particular, we don't learn much about processes driving erosion and sediment transport. Field measurements and numerical modelling of the relevant processes are needed. We may also get a false impression that long-term erosion is occurring if the comparison photographs were taken soon after a major storm event. In Sweden, storms are most likely in winter, and aerial photography is completed in spring. There is then a risk that long-term erosion may be erroneously inferred from the photographed erosional effects of a recent storm, which undergo recovery over the subsequent summer. Context, for example, from weather records, can help to avoid this potential issue. A misleading impression of erosion may also occur if the aerial photography for the comparison year was completed on a windy day. This is because resulting waves will push the water level higher, which gives a false impression of erosion mapped from the waterline. This issue is visible in the 2018 aerial photo shown here. However, it can be avoided, as shown here, by mapping the dune footline. Precision and accuracy can be poor if images are of low quality. For example, it can be difficult to determine where the shoreline is on the old black and white photographs, as shown in this image. However, this issue can again be avoided by mapping the dune footline. Vegetation, including overhanging trees and dead seagrass deposited by waves on the beach, may also obscure the dune foot or shorelines you wish to map, as shown in this image. So, what can we say about long-term erosion in Skåne from our aerial photograph analyses? Erosion has been a long-term problem in some locations over recent decades, including Espet, Lerup Strandbad, Istad, Enkelholm, and Borstad. An analysis of Enkelholm is shown in the image. Longshore sediment transport is a key driver of erosion in these locations, and you can read more about the erosion at these sites by visiting these websites. There are a number of things that we need to do to improve our understanding of coastal erosion in southern Sweden. These include developing a consistent methodology. For example, what features do we map? Integrating our different studies into a single long-term assessment, and complementing this work with other methods that allow us to learn more about the processes of erosion. We have started to do this through, for example, numerical modelling of longshore currents and potential sediment transport from historical wind and wave data. Developing predictions for future responses of the coastline to rising sea level. This is the subject of a new four-year research project beginning in 2022 and involving collaboration between the Swedish Geotechnical Institute, Lund University, the Geological Survey of Sweden, and Länsstyrelsen Skåne. This now concludes this vignette. You're invited to explore the various resources available online that have been presented here.